is DJ Schweitzer. I am Jeremy Lance. And the Premier League is underway. It's up and rolling. We have matches to talk about. We have things to care about. Stuff we saw. TV/streaming scenarios that we can complain about. All the good stuff. All the things that soccer Twitter loves. Hating things. And not wanting to pay for things. Overreacting about things. That's tonight's episode. Welcome aboard.
Well, man, what an intro. If you haven't turned it off by now, hopefully you're enjoying marginally better audio from me for the first time. We now have a microphone. I tweeted about this earlier. I think, too, what was really fun about the Premier League being back, and you mentioned all those things, it was like we had like a three-week break from like all of the moaning that is soccer Twitter, and everyone was so excited about it to come back, and then it all slammed into us at the same time.
Yeah.
And it was like Premier League overload to a certain extent.
But you know, for a moment, like the good old days, we were all just on team soccer. Remember those? Remember the days of team soccer? Were you just happy that other people actually liked the goofy niche sport that you liked?
But before there was Twitter and before your Twitter timeline beat. Is you're just trying, yeah, before you could like go into Twitter and like while trying to focus on soccer, then all this political stuff pours into your timeline through various sources and you're like, damn it, I mean, I can't even enjoy this for a little bit without seeing some of this nonsense. It was once upon a time a nice life when you'd see like another person in a soccer jersey, that rare occurrence, and you'd like hat tip at them a little bit from like across the room and acknowledge as we both watched that one game on that one TV that was on silent, and we'd both gathered there for that, but you know, we knew that we were there in concert together on team soccer.
I miss team soccer. We don't have team soccer tonight. We do have Premier League matches. We will also do the thing we always do after week one, which is rate our favorite and least favorite kits of the new season. We'll talk a little bit of MLS. MLS is still existing as a season, sort of. They've added a couple more games. How many more after that? Nobody really knows. Playoffs. A guess is going to happen at some point in time.
Maybe
we'll just be like March Madness is possibly going to be, and just everybody gets into the playoffs. Hey, you're all invited.
That'd be awesome.
We'll go ahead and like rename the playoffs. Like we'll give it a name and then just put it in Orlando. Oh wait, we already did that.
It's Orlando 2. I mean, Disney's all about the sequels. Why can't we have an Orlando sequel?
Orlando 2, Electric Boogaloo. We do have all that to talk about. First thing we need to get out of the way is fantasy.
Yeah, I mean, you sounded excited about it, and I would understand why you were excited about it, because I'm not even sure that you signed up for it. Is this what you're doing? You're just abandoning.
I forgot to restart the league.
Okay, good. So I'm not just missing out on something here.
No, let me take that back. I forgot until it was basically too late. Like, the Arsenal-Fulham match had already kicked off. But I got on there, and I filled out my team. And then, like, I tried to submit it, and it was just, like, jacking up on me. And I was just like, I'll deal with that later. And later has yet to occur.
Well, fair enough. As of right now, you are currently 93rd in our league of 92 people. I find myself not too much better off. I'm in 70th place after a ho-hum early start to the campaign. Sitting at the top of the table, though, on the Premier League side of things is David Enfield's Bad Captains. He's sitting in the top spot with a monster first week of 109 points. Which I like.
He must have had a front line of what, like, Aubameyang, Vardy,
Salah,
scored in this season. Yeah. Salah. So he had those three as his front three. One of those was captained. Must have had, like, all of his defenders had clean sheets. Keeper had clean sheets. And then, like, goals throughout his midfield.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, that has to be it.
109 points is an obscene number of points in a match week. I'm sure, like, people who are actually good at fantasy probably scoff at us, like, getting awed over that point total.
Well, I mean, my public school math tells me that means that almost every player on his team, basically, they were all averaging almost 10 points.
Yeah.
That's a lot.
It was a good public school that you went to there in Lakota there, Jeremy.
That's a lot of points. I feel like most weeks, like, half my team barely scores more than, like, 2 points. So to have basically everybody averaging almost 10 is wild.
Yeah, well, that's why we're at this end of the table and they're at that end of the table. So congrats to David on logging that great first week, off to an early jump in the competition for the Added Time Outfitters Monthly Prize on that front. If you haven't yet signed up for the league, go to our Twitter feed, go to our Facebook feed. You'll be able to find links to the actual league itself, auto links, as well as the code. So you can join in. You can join in on a weekly and monthly basis. Your point totals will be accrued based off of when you joined. So looking forward to seeing you in the league and having a chance to win a free monthly chance at winning a Added Time Outfitters wristband. I did check in, too, on the MLS League. It is actually up and running. And look in to
see. How about
see
that?
Yeah, believe it or not, we have a new leader. You and I actually moved positions in the table. So this is all based off of the last time we checked in on things, which had been like last season as far as the show is concerned. Yeah. So sitting on top of the table, Jones's field projections is on top for the first show in a row. So congrats to him. No clue if he was there last week or not. But
way to go. He could have been there for a month and we don't even know.
Yeah, we have no clue. I am in 39th place out of 39 people in the league. That was a fall of 5 places for me. So I'm sitting bottom of the pile. You are just above me, 36th place. You fell 21 places since we last checked in. So I'm guessing that's mostly because you also have not checked in on your team since we last checked in.
I haven't checked in, but at least unlike my Premier League team, this one exists. So
it does exist. I checked to make sure that we were both alive there.
I have 11 players selected. Like, I actually, there's points to be gained.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Do you have any more? Are we ready to roll to the start of the season?
Yeah, let's get out of this as quickly as possible.
Remind me, I need to probably set up my Premier League team. Let's start with the Premier League season off and rolling. Some teams, great start. Some teams, not so much. Let's start with the good. And we'll start, obviously, at the top of the table, or at least how the top of the table was last season. Liverpool getting past Leeds in a extremely early contender for match of the season, as new boys Leeds, who it had been a minute since they had been in the Premier League, come in guns blazing and go toe-to-toe with Liverpool, ultimately falling 4-3 in this one. But, man, that was a good way to start the season off.
Yeah, I mean, it was a great way to start the season. I was really intrigued to see where you pitted this match as far as good starts versus bad starts. And I think depending on who you're looking at in this particular game, either Liverpool or Leeds, you could go either direction with that. For Liverpool, you know, they got the win.
Right.
This was very not last season Liverpool, at least maybe not after the restart Liverpool. This is more like the season before where they just lost out to City and they like would go guns blazing with everyone they played against. And it would be like a 2-3, a 4-3 match, a 4-2 match where they would just outgun the other side every time out. And this felt a lot like that. And it was a hell of a game to watch. But if you're Liverpool, you have to be slightly concerned that this is still like, and I mentioned this in our preview show, this kind of bad run of form where they just don't quite look like the all-conquering side that they were at the beginning of the last campaign or for a majority of the last campaign. On the flip side of that, when you look at Leeds, yeah, they lost, but man, going toe-to-toe with Liverpool, the champions, is a great way to start the campaign. And while, yeah, you can be upset and take some lessons away from the actual result itself, they have to be pleased with the start that they had to the season.
The Demon Deacon himself, Jack Harrison, getting on the score sheet. Score one for Wake Forest in the ACC on that one. And then, like, you know, like, their other goal scorer in that first half was former Chelsea, up-and-coming prospect turned forever, like, six-year loan player, Patrick Bamford, resurfacing in the Premier League and scoring a goal in that first game. Leeds is going to be a fun story to watch, which direction they go. We don't know. They gave up, they gave up four goals pretty easily. We'll see how that defense sorts itself out. I know they were dealing with a little bit of a depth issue as far as just who was available, but I don't know. I think they're gonna be a fun watch. They're gonna give up a lot of goals probably, but they look like they're up for scoring a decent amount of goals. And obviously with Bielsa, you got that added zestiness to it. So I'm excited. I'm excited to see a promoted side that's going to be fun to watch. I don't think it's a complete bad thing for Liverpool. Like, they got the win in week one, and with the offseason that really wasn't for most clubs, like, that's good enough. Like, get your 3 points and roll on. Survive in advance here in these early stages where most players are still recovering from the previous season.
Yeah, I mean, look, I'm not saying that Liverpool's start to the season was bad, but it is another one of those signs where maybe they're not firing on all their cylinders, or maybe there's a chink in the armor that other teams can exploit. And, you know, this is a newly promoted side, and yeah, it's Bielsa, and yeah, they've got some fun attacking talents within this Leeds side, but Liverpool, the champions, really should be able to sweep aside a newly promoted side, at least when you're looking at, you know, the two squads on paper, that should be something that they should do. And I would imagine Jurgen Klopp probably came away from that match going, whew, well, we escaped with 3 points there in a way that, maybe he wouldn't have felt the same way a couple years ago. That said, look, champions win however they can. And even if it's a newly promoted side, they found a way to get the job done despite maybe not having their best day at the office.
But, you know, to your point, though, I can't remember off the top of my head that many times last season that Liverpool was giving up three goals. Like, that wasn't really a thing they were doing.
Nah, like, but post-pandemic comeback, there was a little bit of a they got drubbed by someone in there. The match is escaping me. But it was after they'd wrapped up the title. And
wasn't it like Watford? Didn't they get smacked like 3-0 by Watford?
Yeah, that's exactly who it was. And it was kind of shocking. But we all kind of put it off as like, they're already on the beach. You know, all they needed was that one win to seal things up, blah, 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 blah. And I think then we kind of saw them stumble a little bit more towards the end of the season. And again, I referenced this last week, that kind of had started before the pandemic had set into place. And you do have to wonder, are there, you know, some cracks that have been papered over? Are people tired? There haven't been the normal breaks that a team would normally get. Even a good side like Liverpool that has to play extra matches, they would have gotten some longer layoffs, and they haven't had that yet. And maybe this is some of the sign that maybe they're going to lose a little bit of that form that they've seen, that they've lifted to the spot that they've been in.
Perhaps, and we shall see. Moving on to other sides having a good start. The team that went out and made a bunch of transactions, Chelsea, they get past Brighton 3-1. A slightly flattering score in a match that everybody was all hyping, like, hey, you know, Timo Werner's going to get his first start. Kai Havertz going to get his first start. So excited. And then who are our goal scorers? Jorginho and Kurt Zuma were two of our goal scorers.
And the other one was Reece James.
Which... Yeah, the other one was Reece James, who starts over Azpilicueta, which is a thing that was kind of like percolating as far as when that was going to happen, and as if this is the true start of Reece James taking over that role that Azpilicueta, the club captain, has kind of, you know, owned for, you know, over half a decade. You're right. He comes in, he plays well. He scores a screamer of a goal. Someone had a great tweet because you had Tariq Lamptey for Brighton had a phenomenal match. Former Chelsea product who was just finally sold off to Brighton. And someone tweeted that Reece James hit that ball with the anger as if he actually had read all those tweets everyone was writing about Lamptey. Because they were really like, oh, why did we get rid of this guy? It's like, well, we got rid of this guy because we have Azpilicueta and then Reece James taking over. That's why we got rid of this guy.
We were comfortable with your departure.
We had some surplus. But yeah, listen, a good start overall for Chelsea. They looked exactly how I expected them to look. They looked tired. They looked... like they had basically half the guys had just met for the first time in the parking lot before the match. This is what I expect. They only debuted two of their new players. You still have Chilwell is coming back from a late season, I believe, ankle injury. You have Thiago Silva literally just got to London like a couple days ago. So he's got to do his whole quarantine and then start training and all that stuff. And then, you know, there's obviously a few other moves possibly on the horizon, but you see how it's going to go. And especially with the window not closing till sometime in October, you know, if some of those moves kind of drag out, you have this weirdness that's going to be this first part of the season for Chelsea where they're just not going to be at their full strength for a while.
Well, with the number of transactions that they had and impact transactions at that, like the amount of money they spent on each of these players tells you that they envision them contributing at least in the near term. But anytime you bring in that many new faces, it's gonna take some time for everyone to kind of get their bearings. I'm not at all complaining about Chilwell coming. I think he's a great player, but this to me, if this isn't Danny Drinkwater 2.0, I just really don't even appropriately know how to approach that situation.
That situation reimagined. Well, no, we got Danny Drinkwater because we literally needed an English player. Didn't matter if he was good or not, we just needed him. We have plenty of English players now. In fact, we're probably gonna get rid of some here soon. We have too many. Yeah, I mean, the Drinkwater thing was kind of a telegraphed bad move, but kind of was what it is. I think Chilwell is going to be good. I don't know about him fully living up to the hype. I think he gets that boost that we see when, you know, English players perform well. They get this extra elevated higher level of rating within the Premier League. And that's why, you know, it's a high price and, you know, this high bar of what is expected out of this player.
Yeah. I mean, it's, it's going to be a tough proving ground at Chelsea, regardless of who they are, whether it's an established player, someone who's been there for, you know, just a little bit of time, like, you know, these new class of youngsters who Chelsea had to lean on last year, to all these new players that are coming through as well. So it's going to be a very interesting time for the Blues, that's for sure.
And you had Kepa giving up, having a very suspect match, had a few decent saves, also got him, did two things that he's done a lot in the past that has not kept him in good favor with the fans or the manager at this point, which is go out to play a ball off on a corner and get caught out and completely whiff at trying to play the ball. And then just being stuck out. He did that on a corner and survived. And then he gave up a shot, like a decent long range shot from outside the box that kind of cuts across the goal. He's been giving those up the entire time he's been here, like on a fairly regular clip. Like even games like, you know, this one today where like we're taking care of business. If they're going to score one goal, it's going to be just an absolute shot straight across goal that Kepa's going to misread and not time his jump.
Well, I'm sure you guys can find a little extra money to spend of Romans and rectify that problem.
Allegedly, we already have. Allegedly, Mendy is already in London, already took his medical, and will probably be announced. Might be announced by the time, like, even before this podcast is up. So that could be happening pretty quickly.
Well, it's a might be, then it almost certainly will be with how quickly I get things edited. Let's move on to another side who I think had a good week, right? I would presume that Arsenal fans feel like they probably are still having a good week, right?
I mean, 3-0 wins, a 3-0 win. Is it against a Fulham side that came out and looked every bit as bad as we feared they would be? Yeah, but Arsenal took care of business, and you got to be able to take care of business even against bad sides. You gotta not play down to them, and you got to handle yourself. And they did. Aubameyang off to a hot start. And Arsenal on the whole, like, you know, you had the Community Shield and, you know, a few other things, the FA Cup, and, like, they're kind of walking into this season with a bit of confidence that they don't normally have at this juncture.
Yeah. There's definitely a swagger to the side right now that we haven't seen from Arsenal in quite some time. We have seen a little bit of this out of them over the last few years. The last, you know, lingering campaigns of Wenger's term in office at Arsenal. He would have a few little spurts like this, again, under Emery, too. We've kind of seen these moments where they've put together a little bit of a run, and they look like, hey, this is old Arsenal again. And then we start talking a bit about the good players. Yeah, and like, hey, remember they've got these guys in their team. You know, Lacazette and Aubameyang, like, both of them. Have you guys forgotten about this? And then they shoot themselves in the foot again when they get against a side that I was going to say that they would, you know, maybe be more evenly matched with, but they tend to do it against worse sides than them, too. And this match, if you remember, way back at the very beginning of the match, they nearly crapped the bed like 2 minutes into the game. And then just a few minutes later, they pulled ahead. And then, you know, the rest of the match transpired the way that it did. But Arsenal were just nearly there for resetting themselves off of this path of positivity they found themselves on. You know, they ended the last campaign with the FA Cup victory. Then they roll into the new season with the Community Shield title. And now they've got this good start to the Premier League campaign. We're looking at a 3-0 win, and it was a decided 3-0 win. But they were just on the precipice of falling off of that upward trajectory. And it just It was a great start for them. I'm not diminishing them. They do look like they're playing well at the moment, and their new additions seem to be making some impact already. But man, I feel like they're a bad stomach punch away from finding themselves back in the doldrums.
Yeah, that they always do seem that way. As I mentioned, the Fulham, every bit as crap as we thought they'd be.
Yeah, I mean, when you don't really invest in your squad at all again, when you've come up kind of almost exactly like they did last time around, it's not really that surprising, right? That they found themselves in this type of position. And excuse me, they did invest last time around and it all went bust. But I mean, there's just no way that you can come up into this Premier League now and not spend some money and expect to be successful with a championship squad.
Yeah, you got to be able to spend some money or have some sort of formula in your squad that just allows you to consistently go out and survive and put on the just amount of needed effort and shift that your side can do, like a Burnley or a Bournemouth stays around for as long as they did. They, you know, obviously don't spend much money in that time. Burnley is hung around doing seems like almost next to nothing in the transfer window for years. But obviously, as we saw with Bournemouth, you know, like that has a shelf life too, and possibly Burnley's expiration date's about to hit. So we'll see. Another side that has a good start to embrace for the week one of the season is a side that had a bad restart after things were shut down last season. And that was Leicester City, who tumbled out of Champions League spots at the end of last year, but looked pretty good as they rolled past West Brom. West Brom, also garbage.
Yeah. I mean, both of us picked both Fulham and West Brom to go down in our season preview, and they opened the season in a way that you'd expect teams that everyone's betting on going down to start the season. But yeah, Leicester really like got themselves back on track in a way that you would kind of hope they would. And seeing Vardy, you know, two late penalties, but twice on the score sheet, he's picking up his golden boot ways again. And then, you know, another one earlier on, this is what Brendan Rodgers' side needed to do to try to remain competitive and remain in the hunt for those European places once again.
Let's talk about teams now that maybe did not have a good start. Where do you want to start with this? Was there a particular team you want to start with that did not have a good start? Anyone, anywhere you want to start?
Man, I can't help but feel like you're alluding to something here.
Yeah, I mean, just wherever you wanted to start, it doesn't matter. We'll get to all of them, but wherever you wanted to start.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, I think a good place to start would probably be in London, okay, with West Ham having another bad start, right?
That's sure what
we're talking about.
They get blanked by Newcastle. That was a rough start. Not overly unexpected. It's a David Moyes side. We can't really put the bar too high for that group. Honestly, can't put the bar too high for Newcastle. I don't think anyone expects them to do anything but barely survive this year.
I picked them as my dark horse side this year. And Callum Wilson, a new signing that they brought in from Bournemouth, certainly getting off to a good start with a second half strike for them. So, I think it was a good start for the Magpies, especially with all the uncertainty that they found themselves in of late when it comes to their ownership situation. So, cheers to them.
I did see that they are possibly looking to offload the American, DeAndre Yedlin.
Yeah, I've seen that as well. So
I don't know. Where would he go? Like, would there be another Premier League side that would run after him? Would it be like a championship side that's looking to make a promotion run? Does he come back here?
I don't know. You get the impression that he would probably want to stay in Europe.
Yeah.
And I think probably a championship side would make sense for him, unless he can guarantee himself that he's going to get regular routine minutes at another Premier League club.
All right, well, Derby County, call your office.
right.
Sheffield United also with a rough start as they fall to Wolves. Wolves getting on the score sheet, I think, in the third minute. I think they had two goals in like 7 minutes or something like that in this match. It was a bad start for Sheffield United, a bad start for Aaron Ramsdale, a great start for Wolves. I don't know, Sheffield Wednesday or Sheffield United, are they going to be kind of a one-trick pony? Are they going to be one and done in the Premier League?
Yeah, I'd kind of speculated that this year was going to be a difficult one for them. They came up playing this very unique style that was very much their own kind of unique brand of football. And we all questioned whether they could do it last year, and they all made us eat crow, and not only eat that crow, but then did one better and kind of exceeded expectations at bare minimum. So what I'd projected was this year, though, that people would have figured out solutions for how to deal with their unique way of playing with these overlapping center backs that are so central to this entire dynamic. And I think we're starting to see that. And look, Wolves are a good side. They have a good manager. They have good players. It's not at all surprising to see them continue to ticking upward as well.
Sure.
But Sheffield United, they've not really gone out and made any blockbuster moves again. And, you know, what we've seen is, yeah, maybe 1 year you can get away with that as a promoted side. But 2-3 years of that is how you end up in a situation like a Bournemouth, like a Burnley, where you're fighting for your life year in, year out. And I feel like the advantage that United system gave them is starting to slowly slip away on them a bit.
Yeah, you know, you wonder with a side like that, again, you know, similar to what we talked about earlier, you know, was last year their ceiling, and they're just going to try to survive, and unless they start making it more player investments, are they just going to be that club that's just barely hanging on? Because it's hard to not see last season as almost surely the ceiling for them in the Premier League.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be hard to see them going much higher, that's for certain.
Another team, and I don't know if you heard about this, that did not have a good start. Spurs. Falling to Everton. Everton, obviously, they went out. They made some moves. Those moves, at least as far as match day one was concerned, looked like good moves. Looked like moves that worked out really well. That Allen guy was phenomenal. James Rodriguez looked up for it. Everton wins. Spurs lose. Spurs looked, I mean, even I think Mourinho even kind of mentioned it. Like, they just looked like they were just not ready for the season to start, just from a physical standpoint.
Yeah, I just re-poured myself a new drink to answer this specifically, because, yeah, it was not a great start for Mourinho's Spurs in his now second year. This is supposed to be the year, and it certainly didn't have
happens.
Yeah, it certainly didn't feel like magic, and didn't look too much like magic. There were some moments in the match where Spurs looked like Spurs and had some threatening attacks, but yeah, I'm stuck in between whether it was like a purely bad Spurs showing or whether it was also like Everton were that good, and I can't tell if Spurs made them look that good or if they truly were that good. It's kind of the pendulum swings both ways for both teams. I was extremely impressed by Allen. I also thought that James Rodriguez looked good on his debut for the club too. And Decore had a decent showing as well. So Everton are newfangled, and this was a great result for Ancelotti. But we're going to have to wait and see if they can put these type of results together week after week, and maybe against sides who are actually better than Spurs.
Yeah, I should have brought this up with some of the other clubs we've talked about so far. But, yeah, I mentioned a bit ago that the transfer window goes through mid-October. Is Spurs still in need of making a move? Are they likely to make a move? Like, I mean, what does that outlook look like?
Yes, yes, all the yeses. We need to make a move desperately. I'm not trying to cut you off specifically, but we desperately need to make a move. We need another striker. And while the club did sign one this week, it was Alex Morgan. It wasn't for the men's squad. It was for their women's squad. Huge signing for Spurs ladies. But for the men's team, they're still looking for anyone to provide some sort of relief for Harry Kane and Heung-Min's son, who've been carrying this load for Spurs for so long. And I can't imagine that they're not looking for some sort of a deal for anyone. And why they've not done the Troy Deeney deal yet, I just have yet to figure out.
Yeah, I was going to say, the Troy Deeney deal makes sense. Heck, I'm surprised they haven't tried to get Chelsea to loan him like Giroud or something like that.
I would love Giroud. That would be great. I mean, that's right up Mourinho's alley too. So
yeah.
I don't know. I feel like they need to make a move, but I mean, this is Spurs, so I'm fully expecting them not to.
Well, that's exciting. The other thing you mentioned, the needing a second striker, and you've mentioned it. Everyone I've talked to that sports Spurs has mentioned it. what Mourinho has basically mentioned it. But the other thing that changed dramatically for you guys in this offseason is your center back situation. Is that in a place where it's good enough? Or is that somewhere that's also going to need to be improved, whether it's this window or one of the next two?
I mean, I think of the most like high key areas in the squad, while striker has been a lingering area of concern for a long time, center back is like that one that's just creeping by a lot of Spurs supporters right now. And yeah, if you look through their ranks right now, they have Sanchez, they have Alderweireld, and then they have Tanganga, and then they have
Eric Dier, technically.
Yeah, I mean, they keep saying that Eric Dier is actually going to be a center back, but he just seems a little mistake prone in a way that I'm just not wholly comfortable with. And maybe he's going to grow into this role that Mourinho wants him to be in, but I would think they would need to at least go out and buy someone who's going to at least provide coverage if they're not able to field the players they're wanting to field at the moment.
I don't know. Is there any other? So City and United didn't play. They had their matches moved for reasons I don't think I fully understood. But they didn't have first week matches. It just didn't happen. Didn't happen. I got nothing more on that. So that I don't know if there's anything else you want to hit on. I think we're ready to kind of look at some kits, right?
Yeah, I mean, this is one of my favorite segments of the entire season, where we get to go through some of our favorites and not so favorites for all of the new kits that drop for the Premier League campaign. I'm a giant kit nerd. We've talked about this at length. I know you are too. So this is just, it's bread and butter stuff. I feel like I'm leafing through the old Eurosport catalog that just showed up on my doorstep, and I'm getting to look through all the latest things that we're going to see on the TV this year. And I don't know about you, but it just always gets me warm and tingly on the inside.
No, it's exciting. A little wonky this year with, you know, some clubs having already unveiled some of their kits.
It's been like a growing thing the last few years. And I feel like Chelsea are like one of the repeat offenders there.
Well, I mean, so Chelsea, basically, they were forced to because their contract with Yokohama ended July 1. So with all those matches, with the whole restart happening really after that and all those matches, they had to jump to their new shirts because it had their current shirt sponsor of 3 Digital that they were then under contract with at that point. So their hand was kind of forced on it this year.
Well, I mean, I'm not necessarily faulting them, but it is something that we've seen more and more is like the last few games of a campaign, we'll see a club debut next season's kits to hopefully, you know, stemmy some excitement and spurn some more sales over the summer. But last year's contract situations really presented a unique situation as we saw a lot of kits get debuted before this season actually kicked off. But now that we've seen just about the full complement of all of the Premier League kits that are going to be played in this year, let's go through. Do you want to just go through our top three for each of us first?
We'll just ping pong it here. Yeah, let's go top three first. I'll start the Manchester City coronavirus kit, which is just what I'm calling it. I don't know what its actual name is. But there, I think it's their third. I don't think it's their away. Their third that's kind of got those like weird, just like organism amoeba looking designs
throughout. I love how you're describing this. This is actually a particular type of cloth pattern.
Sure.
That's called Paisley.
It's called coronavirus.
The coronavirus. If your mom had like a Vera Bradley bag at all. This may have been a pattern that you have seen adorn it. It's interesting that you picked that. I really, as someone who's really into fashion, I want to like this kit, but I actually have it in my three misses category.
Really? Okay. I don't know. I worked for me. I just like I think what really made it work for me is the whole color scheme that they went with that just kind of very light, the whites and the very light blues and the grays and everything, just kind of made it a cool, subtle, but still like, you know, the pattern itself still stands out. I don't know. I like it. Very timely, very topical for it to just look like a bunch of coronaviruses. So good on them.
I love that you're calling it the coronavirus kit. I'll say this much. I have a feeling that when I see it on the pitch, I think I'm actually going to like it. I went and, like, after I saw it for the first time, I was like, all right, I need to see what they're going to wear it with. Because if the whole damn kit looks like this, it's going to be too much. Well, they've got, like, some really plain navy shorts to give it some contrast. And they've got these kind of cool-looking off-white socks that they're going to wear them with, too. So I have it in my bottom three right now, I have the sneaking suspicion that I'm actually going to end up liking it.
Fair enough. Give me one of your favorites.
Yeah, so I'm going to stick with Puma here because in fact, I'm going to stay with Manchester City because I thought their actual away kit for this year, I think, is kind of amazing. They have a pattern, this kind of sublimated jacquard pattern that calls out the Castlefield and Bridgewater Canal area of Manchester, which is kind of this famous area where a really important rail line and canal meet. And there's like some cool pattern to it, and it's all black with these gold accents. And I just think it looks super clean and sharp, while still having some unique details to it.
Awesome. One of my other that I really like is actually Chelsea's away kit. Again, sticking with that like very light blue style, but something they really haven't done in a long time, which is to kind of have a kit that is blue, but a very different blue than what they're known for. And I think it really works. Like I actually plan on probably buying this kit, probably the new, you know, number 10 Pulisic in that away light blue.
I was just getting ready to ask which Chelsea kit you're going to be ordering this year, and you went ahead and answered the question for me.
I mean, I've been waiting to get an American Chelsea kit since, I don't know, 2010, when there was a faint rumor that Landon Donovan was going to sign with Chelsea. That obviously never happened and never even remotely happened, but I got my hopes up for like probably like a 3-day stretch.
Well, you know, you always could have gone out and gotten yourself a proper American Defender Chelsea jersey, or, you know, not that he ever actually got the chance to wear it for
them.
He had
2 minutes. He had 2 minutes in that Premier League, that Matt Miazga.
Yeah. Well,
what else you got?
Yeah. So another good one on my list. I'm going to stay in Puma. I don't know why Puma, they really upped their game, especially after they just landed Neymar too as one of their key endorsements. But I really liked, and I saw it for the first time this weekend when I watched them play, Crystal Palace's Puma kits this year, I think, just look really solid. They've got these really wide, bold, thick stripes that still capture that traditional Palace look. But then they all go and end into this kind of upward-pointing blue blocking at the top of the shoulders that I thought it looked really clean while still providing a really strong brand identity that they've kind of built up for themselves over the years with these red and blue stripes. And
man, yeah, it's cool that they made their entire three kit line essentially the same style, just different base color.
So the main kit is their traditional blue with the red stripes, and then their aways are white, and then where the other stripes would be, it was red and blue as the secondary accents. And then their third is a black one with the red and blue too. But yeah, I agree with you. I think it was cool to kind of see that. That's kind of like an old school thought to like how uniforms work. Like it used to be like you had the same uniform, but just the colors were different for home and away. Now we're seeing teams do like crazy different designs for each of their kits. And the Puma line for Palace this year has a really cool, like, branding aspect to it.
No, I love it. You know, the other one for me and my my kits that I really like is the Wolves away kit, which is, I don't know if you've seen it yet. So it's got white shoulders, navy and yellow you know, cuff or whatever, but then the actual like torso part of the kit is this like blue and white like tie-dye looking pattern.
Yeah, that was another one of those ones where I kind of wanted to like it, but I don't know that I can, and maybe I need to see how they're going to pair it up with shorts and socks. But it feels quite like one of those mishmashes where like they let a 5-year-old pick what their colors were going to be this year, and or like someone just threw a dart blindly at a board and that's the color they landed on.
I love me a mishmash. What can I say?
That's right. So we've talked about ones we've liked and then me kind of interjecting in a few that I didn't like. Let's focus in. Who's one that you really didn't like?
You know, we talked about the Crystal Palace kits, and the one Crystal Palace kit that was really bad was the one that Chelsea's going to wear as their third kit.
Yeah, what the hell is that?
I don't know. This is the most baffling thing they've done kit-wise to Chelsea in... probably going all the way back to, like, the late 2000s when they wore, like, a kit that was basically like the like yellow greenish kind of bright color that you would wear if you were like working on a construction site
or like, yeah, you're, like a city worker. The highlighter kit.
Those are bad. This is like a whole new bad where it's like it's one thing for Chelsea to, you know, everyone always deviates on that third kid. It's something very different than the norm. There's deviating from what you do, and then there's basically just deviating from what you do to do something that someone else does on a normal basis. And doing a kit that is basically a red and blue striped Crystal Palace looking kit, a kit that they've had many times. It looked exactly like that. Has Crystal Palace. I don't know. I don't get it. And also, I mean, you know, I've mentioned it for years now. Anytime Chelsea puts a little bit of red on the collar, on the cuff, somewhere in the design, that's just a little splash of red, there is a contingency of Chelsea supporters that freak out. Because we don't wear red. That's what our rivals wear. We're blue. We're Chelsea. We wear blue. I'm pretty sure those people spontaneously combusted when they saw this kid. Like, those, their head just flew off.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't like they just put red on there. It was they were like, hey, what if we made our third kits look almost exactly like the kits for one of our closest rivals?
Such a bad miss. Gosh, yeah, it's, I have not hated a Chelsea kit this badly in a while.
I love the disdain for it. I'm giggling so much that I've started to realize that we skipped over entirely the third kit that I actually really loved.
Okay.
And it's, but it fits well because it's one that I think everyone actually hates. And it's Manchester United's new fancy
zebra
looking kit. If you want to get technical about what it actually is, it's called Dazzle Camouflage.
I'm with you. I actually really like it.
I think they're fantastic. I think, too, if you hear the story behind the actual design pattern, I think it makes it even better. I actually first looked into Dazzle Camouflage itself.
Where'd you go?
Back a little while ago when the NPSL's Minneapolis City debuted a kit that featured Dazzle Camouflage. If you're not familiar with what Dazzle Camouflage is, it's supposed to be a like hiding in plain sight type of camouflage. It's not supposed to hide you from being visible. It's supposed to make you difficult for you to understand what someone looks like from a distance, to judge how large they are, how fast they're moving, what direction they're moving. And I could see it potentially having those same type of effects on the field. I don't know that it actually would, but I think these kits look awesome, and there are loads of people who are trashing them, and I'll die on this hill.
No, they remind me a lot of the Roger Federer Jordans that came out like 5 years ago.
Yes.
Very similar kind of pattern and scheme to it, with the white and the red with the black, and kind of some of the zigzaggy kind of ness to it. I like them. I like them. But you're right. They have been getting murdered on the Twitter.com over it.
Well, I think they're fancy. So good move there, Adidas and United. One kit I do actually hate. We already named the Manchester City one. I really dislike. The other one that I dislike is Arsenal's new away kit. The white with the red marble veins in it. That's another one that like I feel like I should like from a fashion standpoint, but I felt like it just didn't hit the way that I would have liked for it to. And maybe it's just my inherent bias against Arsenal here, but I just really didn't like the execution of the marble look.
Yeah, you know, I didn't put it on my list, but I did definitely consider it. Ultimately, I went with Arsenal's that blue kit because it's just not their thing. Like, it's almost like what Chelsea's third kit is. Like, it's just like, this is not you. Like, this is not who you are. This is not your identity. This is someone else's identity.
Another one that I really disliked for this year was And again, it's my team. But Spurs third kit for this year, they have a yellow where it's the crest, then the Nike logo, then the sponsor logo, all lined up right down the center of the chest. I don't know what it is, but I despise center aligned like kits in general. I like the badge and the crest to be on separate sides.
Sure.
Because I always feel like when they're centrally aligned, the crest becomes minimized so that everything else can fit in the plain viewing area. And it just always ends up, I feel like, taking away, like it ends up feeling more like a brand advertisement than it does an actual kit.
My other one was Spurs' home kit. I think it's just boxy and dull. I don't like that blue stripe on the, like, right at the shoulder. I think it just makes him, you look like you're wearing, like, a crappy NFL jersey or something like that.
Yeah. It looks like a Patriots knockoff.
Yeah. It's just got a weird, like, should there be shoulder pads under that? Like, it's just very boxy, weird kind of vibe on the shoulders.
Hey, their stadium is the NFL London Stadium now. So maybe that's the inspiration.
Put some shoulder pads on.
Why not? Keeps the injury record a little bit better. Yeah, all three Spurs kits this year are a bit of a miss in my opinion.
I like the color, that green color they're going with. I don't know if it particularly wows me or is like super attractive looking, but like I do like that color. It's actually a green that I really desperately want Chelsea to do someday, because their original kits that they wore when they first started, back when it was just like a shirt,
yeah.
like a wool shirt, was I mean, at least as far as what's been documented, is kind of that olivey kind of greenish kind of color.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you're probably like a sneeze away from that probably being Chelsea's jersey color this year, given that they just rotate colors through now for most teams' third kits. And I'm sure the guy who was working on Spurs is probably the same dude who's working on Chelsea. And, you know, if he'd sneeze, it would have blown the colors to the other side of the table. And, you know, that's how they would have ended up with it.
Love it. Yeah. All right. That I don't know. Was there any other kits you wanted to opine on? I got nothing else on that.
No, I mean, there are some other ones that I always think are probably worthy of a little bit of mention. I do like actually all three of the Hummel kits that Everton are rocking this year.
Yeah.
I'm always a sucker for the chevrons that Hummel kits tend to have incorporated in them. Maybe it's just the retro-y look. But in particular, I really dig both their home or their away and their third kits. The aways are like kind of a traditional yellow and blue for Everton. But then they have a really kind of this muted green color that I thought was really cool for the thirds. And then another one that I thought was really good was, and I think this is probably disliked by their fans, but Brighton's kits this year, instead of having the traditional blue and white stripes, they have some white pinstripes on the blue that I think just look sharp. So loads of good kits out there. Most of them are ho-hum, but hey, that's what kits typically are.
You know, I got to say, one set of kits that, like, the kit themselves, I don't have a problem with. But Southampton going with this new logo where it's basically their logo they always had, but, like, in this, like, shield looking like crest with just like a white background and then like the logo on top of it. I don't know. I just don't like that. I like just have the logo. Why do you need like an extra like layer behind it?
It definitely feels a little bit like Pimp My Ride, where it's like a logo with inside a logo.
Yeah.
A crest inside a crest, dog. Heard you like crest, so I put a crest inside your crest. Yeah, it is a little weird in that respect.
And then the only other one that I think like I was like really like, oh, this is awesome. I'm always a sucker for pink kits. Sheffield United's aways are pink. They look pretty good. I dig them.
Yeah, there was someone else who did like the exact same templated kit this year. And for all three of the kids in their range, and that was West Brom. And they've got this kind of like barcode-y looking pattern for their stripes this year. Looks kind of cool on their home kits, but then you go and look at like their thirds where it's red and yellow, and it's literally like screaming at your eyeballs.
Yeah. And I can't, it looks like the kit for like some team in like the Chinese Super League.
Oh, for sure. Or like you know a fake team that you designed in FIFA or something.
Yeah, and then their aways are green and yellow, so it just looks like a Norwich kit.
I literally had to check and see if it was a Norwich jersey. You know, it had a bird on there. I was like, what's going on here? Like, did they accidentally slip this one in?
They snuck back into the Premier League. That's how they get back in.
let's end our jersey dalliance and dip over into Major League Soccer, as it is a league that continues to happen. Hey, if nothing else, we know it will continue happening for at least another three matches.
Yeah, I love that the league has been so gracious as to let us in on what the next basically like week and a half looks like as far as matches.
Thanks, MLS.
I mean, I don't know if I understand the rationale, but it's just kind of a whatever at this point. There was one thing I kind of wanted to focus on. We're not at the halfway point. We don't know what point in the season we're actually at, but like everyone's played a handful of games, like 10 or 11. I thought it would be a good time to have our first kind of reflection on the two expansion sides in the league. I mean, it's something that on a normal season, I feel like there'd be more focus on. But, like, it almost feels like an afterthought that there's two brand new organizations in the league. Just forced to play just rando games right now as we're just kind of just slogging through whatever this is.
It has to be the worst as an expansion side, especially as an owner, when you just plug down like all this money to not only like, you know, pay your expansion fee, but now you're paying all these new salaries that you weren't dealing with before. And you're like, oh, well, at least we've got, you know, the boost of ticket revenue coming in. We'll have good crowds this first season. And then, oh, yeah, by the way, that's not going to be happening at all.
You'll have no crowds. Yeah. I do. The positive side, though, is, like, if you were in Nashville, and let's say, like, you were in Nashville or Miami, and you were like, man, the worst thing we could do is have a season – statistically as bad as what FC Cincinnati just did their first season. And because this season is such a jumbled mess and that no one's going to be playing that many games and everything's kind of segmented, is like, even if they did suck that hard, and Inter Miami so far is sort of doing that, like, it's not clear cut for anyone to actually even notice at this point.
Oh, no.
Like, it's such a jumbled mess that you almost have to, like, make it a point to, like, look on the standings and go, oh, way down there, there's Inter Miami with their, you know, two wins on the season, which I feel like if they were, you know, only two wins out of 11 in a normal season circumstance, like, there'd be some alarm bells going off and some, like, oh, crap, this is going to be a real bad scene for this new side, especially a new side that had positioned themselves as, you know, going to be the next, you know, big club that was going to get all this big signings. Of course, they did get a big signing in Miami, bringing in Higuain this week. So I guess they do have that.
Yeah. Let's clarify though, not Federico Higuain.
No, he's already here. There was no,
yeah, he's still with DC. This is his brother, Gonzalo, you know, the one who's actually the famous one.
Mm-hmm. That one.
Yeah. Major signing for them.
Yeah, so that puts them at, now they're using all three DPs. I don't know. Do they have the right pieces there, though? Like, I
don't know. You look at their DPs. Their DPs are a defensive midfielder, a number 10, and now a number 9, and all three of them are extremely high caliber players.
Yeah,
you know,
for sure.
As far as like if you're trying to invest and spend a ton of money in your team, doing it up the spine is where you want to do it. So I think those are good pieces to have. The question is now is like, will everything else work out around them? And so far, the answer to that question is unequivocally no. But they're also like, what, 12 games into their first season ever? And there was a strong delay in constructing the squad to begin with. I don't know. I think they're having a bad start to the campaign, but I think you're right. The pandemic has certainly been a bit of a band-aid to cover up some of the faults that they probably have in that team.
Nashville, the other side coming into Major League Soccer this season. But by the way, both expansion sides, as of time of recording, have only scored 9 goals each. Not great. That is 2 more goals than FC Cincinnati have currently notched in season number 2. So I guess things could be worse. For Nashville, things are like, I feel like, at least as far as performance, things have been slightly better. But I still don't really know what's going on with this team.
Yeah, I mean, they've not lost in their last 4 matches, which is a good thing. Now, 2 of those games have come against Inter or Miami themselves. So obviously keep that in mind. And then another one came against Orlando. And then they beat down Atlanta 4-2 this past weekend. But Atlanta are like a shell of them former selves. And as we've talked about, they have pretty much shipped off on this season already. So I don't know. I mean, they're doing okay. I think what we would probably be talking about with them if it weren't for all of the things that are going on in the world, we'd probably be talking about how their attendance was kind of crappy and they were like an okay team on top of that. And we'd be really concerned about their future. I think this has been a massively good thing for them, even more so than it's been for Miami in that respect.
Yeah, no, I think because of the situation and how things are just not, we just don't have the time to just hyper-focus on a week in and week out for all summer long, different things about these new clubs. We're not focusing on that attendance issue with Nashville. We're not focusing on the fact that Miami is playing in a rehabbed abandoned stadium. We're not talking about the fact that Inter Miami's couldn't even secure themselves a shirt sponsor for their first year. We're not talking about the fact that both teams have pretty crappy jerseys for year one. And I think on the whole, like what that means is like for better or worse, they haven't been given a season, that true first season, where they get an identity, either a bad identity or a good identity. But like they don't really have one. Like neither of them have any semblance of like I can tell you nothing about Nashville. I don't know anything about their supporter culture, just the general vibe about the club. Like if they're what they're trying to build towards, I don't know. And the same thing for Miami. Like it's been such a hot, jumbled 11-match mess that has been this season that like the concrete narratives of what these clubs are just don't exist.
Presuming that everyone comes out of the backside of this, as still viable entities, I think these will mostly be looked at as like a preseason, just one elongated preseason, like a trial run for each of these clubs in their histories. And you'll look back at them and kind of be like, oh, remember that first funny year we had? And then they'll write their other histories, whatever they might be. But
right.
I don't think everyone's going to look at these as much of anything unless for some reason they pull it together and get into the playoffs and manage to make a run there and make some noise in that respect. I think these are just going to be some weird anomalies.
Which again, like kind of goes back to like, this kind of works out for them. Like, sure, they from a revenue standpoint, it's a bad scene, but like as an organization, they get this like quasi season to sort of kind of figure a few things out before people really start to take notice of if they know what the heck they're doing or not.
Yep.
Which other clubs did not get the benefit of.
Thinking someone by the initials of JB here in Cincinnati would have loved a do-over year like this.
Yeah, talk about not that you didn't know what you didn't know. This would have been the chance to finally know what you don't know and then, you know, not make the same mistakes, like, you know, keeping yourself employed as a general manager.
Or, you know, trading for a team's entire set of draft picks.
Yeah, no, that's a good move, too. Yeah. I don't know if Mike Ditka told him to do that, but let's wrap things up. Winners and wankers, your winner.
My winner this week, I'm going with Edison Cavani, one-time Inter-Miami target, still playing in, I think, Paris. Regardless, he has been back in Uruguay during the offseason, and he actually performed with the National Ballet to encourage more male participation in ballet in general and challenge the stigma that it's not for boys. And look, it's not really soccer news, and it's certainly a bit of an advertising ploy, but I thought that was just an amazingly cool crossover. As someone who really appreciates the arts, I think ballet probably gets knocked, particularly because it's not well understood. And I guarantee you some people are now interested in ballet that weren't before because Edison Cavani was willing to make that type of a leap.
And he's got to do something now that he doesn't get to go to Inter-Miami. So,
yeah, that's right.
My winner for this week, and I kind of struggled what to pick, but one cool thing that happened, even with all the whole pandemic and all the situations going on in this city, and actually one that makes more sense almost given the pandemic, is that the central hub, the central meeting ground here in Cincinnati, Fountain Square, actually hosted an outdoor Premier League opening weekend watch party all day.
Yeah, that's super cool.
We were a part of, you know, helping host World Cup watch parties there. They've done that in the past. Since then with the more recent World Cups for the men's and the women's, but for like the Premier League, a league that, like, you know, just a couple of years ago, you would have to fight, you know, a bartender at most places just to get them to turn it on. The fact that like Fountain Square, this main like hangout area in downtown Cincinnati, went out of their way to put together a watch party for that. Pretty cool. Pretty cool that they would do that, and that's like where the Premier League now is within soccer, within sports, at least in Cincinnati.
Yeah. Yeah. No longer just team soccer. It's actually things that general people might have a passing interest in.
We've moved beyond team soccer, but RIP team soccer. Your wanker.
My wanker this week. It had to be, it's gotta be Peacock.
Yeah,
right?
That's mine.
Yeah. Until we know what's really going on with the whole PSG Neymar situation, which I think could yield a multitude of wankers, I have to go with Peacock here. Just look, I understand NBC's strategy. And again, for those of us in the US, we've been super spoiled and given every opportunity to watch just about everything we want for no more than the cost that we're paying for our cable subscription packages for the most part. And we're now getting a small taste of what it's actually like in Europe, where like you have to pay through the nose to watch your team just play on the regular, even if it's your local team. And that sucks, but this is so inevitable. Like, the Premier League knows how to make money in Europe. And if they could prove their model was viable here, they were always going to try to bring it here too.
It's been quite the migration though, for to get to this point, right? Like, when NBC first takes over Premier League rights, they have, obviously, the big matches that they're putting on, you know, NBCSN and, you know, the occasional matches that go on NBC. And then everything else, remember, at the time, was available as long as you had, like, a cable login online, or a lot of cable providers, a lot of the big ones like Comcast and DirecTV and stuff like that, actually had, like, channels, like, additional auxiliary channels that were just Premier League Live Extra channels that had all the other games. So you were getting, you know, the NFL Sunday ticket, if you will, just built into the fact that you had NBC Sports. So at the time, it was, as long as you got cable, you got them all. You got all the games. Mm-hmm. Then we moved to, okay, we're going to have all the marquee games, obviously, on the networks that we already have through, you know, cable and through, you know, NBC. But then all those other games that weren't worthy enough of being on these channels, they're going to be on NBC Gold. And it's $50, and you get all of this, and you get full access to all that. And now we've gone from, it's just the matches that have the smaller followings, the smaller fan bases that aren't the marquee matchups, to the majority of matches, in especially the marquee matches, are now going to be on this extra streaming tier that you got to pay $5 a month, which, to be fair, it's like, you know, you're basically going to even pay like $45, I guess, if you do every month, right? So yeah. I guess you're saving $5. So congratulations. It's somehow slightly cheaper than Gold. But again, they took all the things that we were already getting with the fact that we have cable. We're paying for cable. And they're now taking those things, the things that was, this is what you get with cable, and now those are moving over, and now everything that really matters is going to be on the second tier. I mean, even stuff like Men in Blazers and some of their other productions that they do in relation with their Premier League coverage, that's all over there now, at least for now. I don't know if this is like a full season thing or just like we're just doing this at the beginning of the season to dupe everyone into jumping onto Peacock, and then obviously the good stuff will migrate back over to NBCSN. I don't know if they're doing that, but for right now, that's what it appears.
Well, I mean, I looked this up. The deal for this year is 175 Premier League games are exclusive to Peacock this year. Exclusive. That's almost 9 matches per team, which is what, just under what, how many matches is it? 36 matches. So that's a fourth of the season, or 38, excuse me, but that's a fourth of the season almost that's tucked behind an additional paywall just to watch on top of whatever you're paying to get NBCSN to begin with.
How many matches again did you say?
9. It's almost nine. It's just,
I'm sorry. How many matches total? 170, whatever?
175.
Okay, so 175 matches. There are only 380 matches in the entire season.
Yeah. So, I mean, you're looking at close to half of the total Premier League season is now tucked behind this additional paywall, which, again, like, we should have all seen this coming, especially as the league's popularity grew and NBC was renting out entire buildings to have fan fests all over the country every couple months. These are the things that happen. But what is most frustrating about it is the service sucked. The stream was unreliable. Once you cast it to certain areas,
that's the thing. You have to cast it because they don't have apps on Roku or Fire Stick, which is the primary way that most people stream stuff on their television.
Yeah, I mean, unless you had a Chromecast or an Apple TV, you were just SOL today. And yeah, there were workarounds, and yeah, you could watch on, you know, a smaller screen if you wanted to, but those are compromises that you shouldn't have to be paying additional money for just to watch your team when they've spent the last few years setting the precedent and the bar so damn high for free. So I just, I hate to be like, this is so first world problem. Like, yeah, we can watch the game if we want to, but I don't want to pay for money for a stuttery stream on a service that I can't necessarily watch everywhere. And it's just yet another bill that I'm having to tally up.
Yep.
That, you know, this whole idea of moving to digital was supposed to break this problem. And it's really only just changed the way that we're paying for it.
Right. Instead of paying one $70 bill, you're paying, you know, 15 different smaller bills. That's what it's come down to. I think you hit on something though big. Like, the service has to be, if we're paying extra for it, it's got to be good. And yeah. I feel like this is something that, like, we've dealt with the past couple years with the Champions League, right? Like, Bleacher Report Live, and this year with CBS All Access. Those are two streaming platforms that just didn't seem like they were built out enough to handle live sports, because live sports is a live stream. It's not some kind of downloaded video on demand. It's live sports and a live broadcast that's coming across. And I feel like these services get up and rolling and start charging people before they even have like an actual working product.
Yeah. I mean, even here in Cincinnati, we got to deal with like the mega version of this in Flow Sports. So it's just, oh.
Yeah, that's this on steroids of, we're going to charge you an obscene, like just a dumb price that doesn't even make sense per month. All you're going to get is these matches for this one team, and the service is going to be terrible.
Yeah. I mean, let's be honest here. I have a lot of different credit cards and a lot of different email addresses. And it may be just enough for each of those between me, my wife, and my friends to be able to tally up enough free trials to get through all 9 of Spurs matches on Peacock this season.
And in a year where, while it's happening, starting to happen, not everyone's ready for it, a year where going to a bar is not really an option for everybody. Like, this sucks. Like, I remember the first year NBC Gold came out, and I looked up and I was like, okay, there's like 4 Chelsea matches that are going to be on NBC Gold. I'll just designate those as the 4 times that I'll make it a point to go to the bar and watch the match. And that was fine. But we can't even do that now. Well, there's a pandemic. Most places are closed, and it's kind of hard to get in, and it's awkward, and you're having to, pull your mask down to sip a beer. It's,
You're not even allowed to sing right now, Jeremy. Can't sing in the pub.
How are you going to up the lads?
Yeah, if they can't hear you singing from all the pubs and piped in across the interwebs, how am I supposed to impact my team?
Now we know why Liverpool gave up 3 goals. That's why it happened. But it didn't happen last year, and it totally happened right now.
Explains it all right now. That brings us to the end of this week's show. As always, if you want to get a hold of us, Jeremy's at Jeremy Lance on Twitter. I'm at Wrong Side of Pond. Stay tuned. We've got some cool stuff that we're brewing on behind the scenes, some new content, some new ways we're going to be bringing things to you, such as this new YouTube channel that the show is now found on as well. So keep an eye out for things. There's some cool things on the way.
All right, folks.
Talk to you soon.
Bye. Where you been? Where you gone? Are you coming back? It's been so fucking long since I looked in the mirror and saw someone who